Let's explore Wiretap's advanced features. On the back of the module, you'll find a header with 6 pins and 2 jumpers, labeled Jumper A and Jumper B. This is where you can customize several user-definable settings. Here is the factory default configuration. You can park both jumpers in this position or remove them. Same effect. Let's go through all the settings step by step. We'll start with the clocked operation mode. Activate it by setting jumper A like so. This mode fundamentally changes how Wiretap operates. In clocked operation mode, Wiretap's outputs are only active when a clock or trigger signal is present at input 2. As input 2 is occupied with trigger signals, Wiretap is now down to one CV signal provided by input 1. Here, in our patch, the IntelliGel Metropolis step sequencer supplies the pitch CV for our sequence. The gate output of the Metropolis feeds Wiretap's input 2 with the necessary triggers. For the moment, we'll enable the gates for all 8 steps. This way, Wiretap is operating as usual because every pitch change happens in time with the clock pulse. When the pitch rises, the first envelope fires, opening the low-pass filter. Conversely, when the pitch falls, it triggers the second envelope. We're using that envelope to modulate the timbre of our oscillator, the clavis twin waves, in quad saw mode. Now, let's make proper use of the clocked operation mode by first disabling all gates in the sequence. Since Wiretap's input 2 isn't receiving any gates now, the envelopes are quiet. Let's bring some life back into the sequence by gradually reactivating the gates. Now, envelope 1 and 2 will fire on steps with an active gate. Note that Wiretap's detection circuit only cares about the onset of the gate signal, so the gate length itself is not important. A dual envelope setup like this would be pretty hard to achieve with other modules. Of course, Wiretap adapts to every change of the input signal in real time. Great for live performance. Alternatively, setting jumper A to this configuration will activate the bus gate mode. Now, instead of input 2, Wiretap will draw its input triggers from the Eurorack system bus. This allows input 2 to receive its own input signal again. Certain modules, such as the Varigate 4 Plus by Maleco, can send clock signals on the gate bus using the select bus feature. This will work just as well. Moving on to jumper B. Here, you can switch to an alternative mode called hold mode. By default, Wiretap will send a trigger every time there's a significant change in the input signal. The trigger length can be set with the gate time control. In hold mode, however, the outputs will stay high as long as the required condition is true. The rising output will remain high as long as the input voltage is rising. Likewise, the falling and the moving output when they're active. This mode yields nice results with continuous signals such as LFOs, or manual CVs. To get the most out of stepped CVs, where pitch changes occur rapidly, best apply some portamento to selected steps. Wiretap now latches onto the stretched out input CV changes and generates longer gates accordingly. The step output continues to work normally with a fixed trigger length. By the way, in hold mode, as the gate length is determined by the input signal, the left knob is freed up to control the release time of envelope 1, independent of envelope 2, which retains its dedicated control knob. Note that clocked operation and hold mode can run simultaneously, so different combinations of jumper A and jumper B settings are possible. Let's take a closer look at the gate time control, a topic briefly mentioned in our previous videos. In this very simple patch, Metropolis controls the pitch of our oscillator with Wiretap in the loop. The moving output is patched into the CV input of our low-pass filter, modulating cutoff. When adjusting the gate time, you'll notice that for short durations, Wiretap works normally. However, as we increase the gate length, what happens if a new event arrives before the current gate is closed? In such cases, incoming signals are ignored while the gate is high. This feature can be used creatively. If the events occur periodically, like in our case, you can dial in a gate duration that causes a skip of every other event. Two out of three events, three out of four events, and so on. In essence, it can function as a clock divider in certain conditions. Since Wiretap's envelopes are linked to the gates, tweaking the gate time control adds a nice twist to the frequency and shape of the envelopes. Let's get adventurous and explore how Wiretap handles audio rate signals. Please note that Wiretap wasn't originally designed for this purpose, so what you're about to experience is a glitchy and unconventional use of Wiretap. We'll be using the same sequence from Metropolis to modulate our oscillator, the Instruo TSL. The square wave sub-oscillator and triangle outputs of the TSL are connected to Wiretap's inputs 1 and 2, respectively. We have Wiretap's rising and falling outputs fully panned. That's what we're hearing. Since Wiretap can handle audio rate input signals, we can expect to hear an audio rate response at the outputs. To begin, let's turn the gate time control all the way down to ensure that the gate is as short as possible. This setting generates signals that resemble narrow pulse waves. By altering the gate time, we are effectively controlling the pulse width. As we turn the gate control further up, we enter glitch territory. This is where all sorts of weird artifacts appear, because the input signal's frequency varies while the gate length remains fixed and independent of the input signal's frequency. Since the sub-oscillator is one octave below the triangle signal, these artifacts occur at different frequencies. Now that you've mastered the depths of Wiretap's feature set, We encourage you to experiment. And don't forget to check out our other videos on Wiretap and its sibling, Civilization. Bye for now.